We'll start with Hebrews 10:23. That's where we started yesterday. Hebrews 10:23. And it says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. And so Daddy's been talking about, you know, the confession of our faith. And so the Bible tells us to hold fast to that profession, or we could say confession of faith, without wavering. Why can we do that? For he is faithful that promised. So that's what we were focusing on yesterday, that God is faithful. He is faithful that promised. Praise God. So we can hold fast to our confession. The things we are to say. What are we to say? What God says. Amen. We hold fast to saying the same things that God says. Praise God. So we're to hold fast to it without wavering. So we know that if we waver, if one day we're saying it, the next day we're not. One day we're saying it, the next day we're saying something, but it's something different. That's wavering. And then that means we're not holding fast. If we're wavering, we're not holding fast. So holding fast requires that we continue to say the same thing and we're consistent with it. Praise God. And knowing and reminding ourselves that God is faithful helps us to say the same thing and to keep saying what he has said. And we also went to Hebrews 11:11. Hebrews 11:11, it says, through faith, also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age. Why? Because she judged him faithful who had promised. And so we brought out that God is faithful. We know he's faithful, but we have to judge him faithful. Amen. What does judge mean? That means we come to the conclusion. We decide with all finality that God is faithful. Amen. Praise God. He is faithful. And that will not change. Praise God. It cannot change because God is not a man that he would lie. If he said it, he means it. Praise God. So that is how we're able to hold fast to our confession, because we know God is faithful. Not only do we know he is, but we decide that he's faithful and he's faithful to us. Amen. Our job is to continue to say the word, believe the word, and act on the word. Amen? Amen. Praise God. So that's our part. And when we know and we keep it before us that he is indeed faithful, it's easy. I like the amplified of that 11:11. It says, because Sarah considered God, who had given her the promise, to be reliable, to be trustworthy, and to be true to his word. Because God is reliable, because he's trustworthy, because he's true to his word, we can hold fast to saying the same thing. We can hold fast to saying his word, to continue to keep that in our mouth. Praise God. And Daddy shared with us things to remember, that we always have help. You know, the greater one is in us. Where there's never a supply that comes, there's never a need that comes up that there's not a supply for. We are the healed. These are the things we have to hold fast to and continue to say, to continue to remind ourselves of who we are and whose we are. Praise God, because of whose we are, because of who purchased us. Hallelujah. We have access to all these things, but we have to hold fast to it. And so reminding ourselves that God is faithful helps us to hold fast. And so, you know, I shared a story about when Daddy was going to the airport, he had a Bolt driver that, you know, as soon as he got in the car, he started talking and talking and talking about, you know, how hard things were for him and how nothing was going well. And, this place. But as he was talking, he said something that Daddy was able to take a hold of. He shared about, you know, an awesome way that God had provided for him. And so Daddy was able to say to him, but God's been faithful to you. And at that reminder, the man just, his countenance changed and what he said changed. And he was so grateful to Daddy for reminding him of God's faithfulness. He said, oh, thank you. He has been faithful. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I'm going to go home and I'm going to meditate on this. I'm going to remind myself of this. And it just changed his outlook. Just having something else to attend to changed his whole countenance. And I believe that conversation set himself up for a better 2023. Praise God. Why? Because now he's focusing on the faithfulness of God. He's no longer going to be saying all the things that are not going right. He's going to be reminding himself of the things that are going well, the things that God has done for him. And so that's the homework. I gave us all homework to write down the things that God has done for us, his faithfulness toward us. The things the Holy Ghost will remind you of, some things, these are things that we should be rehearsing on a regular basis and bring them up, you know, in our devotion time, just thanking him for his faithfulness. Even if it's something that maybe might seem small to you, it's big to God. Because you being comfortable, you know, in the sense of you having the things you desire and you like, the things you enjoy, even if it's something as simple as somebody brought you your favorite food, you didn't even ask them to. Praise God. You can rejoice over that. Somebody was thinking of you and you know it was God working in them on your behalf. Maybe it was a bill you had due. You had no idea how it was going to be paid, but God provided. Praise God. You put that on that list and you remind yourself of it every day. My God is faithful. And this is the evidence of it. This is the proof. Praise God. And so the more you meditate on his faithfulness, the more you're going to hold fast to what he's telling you to hold fast to for this year. Praise God. We know the promises, you know, in the word. We're the healed. We are the provided for. We are the rich. We are the redeemed. Praise God. We've already been delivered. We know all those things. We hold fast to it. But the Holy Ghost will talk to you. He may have already said some things to you that he's wanting you to reach for this year. Some things might seem a bit impossible, but that means God's power is waiting for your actions of faith. Praise God. You know you can't do it on your own. You need him. Praise God. If you could do it on your own, then it wouldn't need faith, right? Praise God. So there's things he's putting in your heart, or he's already put there, that he's wanting you to hold fast to. As you meditate on the things that he's already done, the way he's already proved himself faithful in your own life, the greater your grasp will be on those things he wants for you. Yes, right. Praise God. And this is our best year yet. Glory to God. I'm going to keep saying it because I'm expecting it to be the best year yet. Hallelujah. So we have to remind ourselves. And so as we should have been writing down some of the things on our list that God has been talking to us about for this year. But I encourage you also to write down those things that he's already done for you. And, you know, maybe you'll go back to when you were 2 years old. That's fine. You know, it doesn't matter. It's something that ministered to you that it was the faithfulness of God. Only God could have done it for you. You know, you write those things down and keep them before you. And that helps you. That helps you. And really, you know, this practice of keeping these things before us will help us to stay in a position to recognize his leadings. Because we're showing him that we're grateful, we're thankful for what he's done for us, how he's proven himself time and time and time again to be faithful. We're in a place where we're able to recognize, because we're thanking him, Father, thank you for doing this for me. And I want us to be specific. Praise God. And I said, it may not be something you share with anybody else. It may be something you share with your spouse. You know, you work that out. Praise God, between you and God. It's something that you just stir yourself up with. We stir ourselves up in the faith. We stir ourselves up with joy, with peace, all the fruit of the Spirit. We can activate it by feeding on the word and acting on it, right? But we're stirring ourselves up. So we stir ourselves up with this, but then, you know, we have our list of things that he's talking to us about, praise God. And this will really help us You know, this is how we are able to recognize. So we have these things we're believing Him for. We're saying, God, You're so faithful. You've done all these things. And I know that this is what You put on my heart. If You've said it, it will come to pass. I'm going to keep it in my mouth. I'm going to keep confessing it. And then the Holy Spirit will quicken you. Okay, now do this. Begin to do this. Something that often happens in our lives is that the Lord will give us something to start to say. Begin to say this. Begin to say this. Begin to say this. And that's part of us keeping ourselves on the path for what God has for us. He gives us something to say. This is our confession of faith. And so because we're grateful, because we're in a posture of thanksgiving, we're able to recognize those leadings. We're not, you know, if we're constantly thinking of how things are hard, it will continue to be hard for us because we have what we say. So we have to change what we're saying, and we have to keep our confession on what God is saying. Praise God. So that is what we talked about yesterday, and I wanted to encourage you, those of you who may not have heard the teaching, to write those things down, because I believe that will really help us. And I know all of us can think of ways and think of times when God did something for us that only He could have done. And it was just, you know, it was something that we're so grateful for, and we just keep it before us. I like notes. I was sharing how I was looking over some notes from years ago, and I saw some things that God had done that I hadn't thought about in a long time. If we don't rehearse them, we'll forget about them. It's just the truth. So we have to keep it before us. So when we write it down and we add it to our devotional time, you know, we'll be looking at them constantly, and we'll keep it before us. Amen. But another way that I wanted us to focus on today, you know, to keep ourselves in a position to recognize His leadings, is the importance of developing our human spirit. The importance of growing spiritually and developing, praise God. It's something that we've heard about before. It's something that we've taught so many times. But it's important for us to remember that this is the way God does things. You know, we have to be skillful with recognizing these leadings. God has not promised us that we hear a big, booming, loud voice, or that we have a sign written in the heavens and this across the sky, do this. That's not promised. But what is promised? If we look at Romans 8:14, it says, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God." It's promised to us that we'll be led by the Spirit. Praise God. And how does He do this? In verse 16, the Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. If He bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God, then He bears witness with our spirit according to what God has for us. This is how we're promised to be led. This is the only promise we have. Everything else is as the Spirit wills. If He wants to give us a word from somebody else, then that's, He can move however He wants to, but it's not promised. And we need to know, and we're taught very well here, that anything, any word anybody gives us should bear witness with our own spirit. Many times it's something the Lord has already been dealing with us about. And you come to service and there's a word that comes forth, or the subject that's ministered on is right in line with what God has already been dealing with us about. So it just confirms it for us. But we're led by the Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
And so we have to keep ourselves in a place that we can recognize His leadings. And because this is, you know, a still small voice, it's the voice of our spirit. Praise God. It's the Holy Spirit bearing witness with our spirit. It's not something that you're going to hear if you're too noisy, if you're too loud, if there's too much stuff. Remember, that's why Pastor said to us two times, Sunday and Tuesday, relax. He told us, relax. Why? We have to be still and know.
Hallelujah.
Be still and know. You know, with our children, if they're, you know, if they're too wound up, they're not hearing you. They can't hear the direction you're giving them. They're too wound up. Maybe they had too much sugar, or maybe they're really sleepy. I know sometimes, you know, if some of the children, if one in particular, if he's too sleepy, then he gets all wound up and it's difficult to get things across to him. He has to calm down. It's the same thing with us. If we're too wound up, God can't get to us what he's trying to get to us. He won't override certain things. If we're choosing to focus on the things of the flesh, he's not going to override that. That's our own choice. We have to choose to mind the things of the Spirit. So it's a choice that we have to make. If you see in Romans 8:5, it says, "For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit mind the things of the Spirit." So we decide if we're going to mind the things of the flesh or mind the things of the Spirit. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it goes on in the Amplified Classic, it makes it even more clear. "For those who are according to the flesh and are controlled," something is controlling us. It's either the flesh or the Spirit. There's no in between. It's either the flesh or the Spirit. So those who are according to the flesh are controlled by its unholy desires, set their minds on and pursue those things which gratify the flesh. But those who are according to the Spirit and are controlled by the desires of the Spirit, set their minds on and seek those things which gratify the Holy Spirit. So because we are in Christ, we're new creatures. We're a brand new creation. Hallelujah. Old things are passed away. Behold, the new is come. We're brand new. Because we are in Christ, we are of the Spirit. So our job is to mind, to be interested in, and allow ourselves to be controlled by the things of the Spirit. And we know from Romans 8:8, it tells us, "So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God." Cannot. Even if you want to, if you are carnally minded, if you are minding the things of the flesh, you cannot please God. The Amplified says, "So then those who are living the life of the flesh, catering to the appetites and impulses of their carnal nature, cannot please or satisfy God or be acceptable to him." Wow. So what does that mean? Those who are living the life of the flesh, those living the life of, you know, doing things that they want to do. It's apart from the word, or even it's apart from what God has told them to do. It's not of him. And so if you're catering to the appetites and impulses of your carnal nature, what is the carnal nature? To do whatever it feels like doing. I tell you what, there's so many things that it wasn't our desire, like, you know, in our flesh to do. But when we gave ourselves to doing what God had ordained for us to do, there's so much joy in it. But if you don't even mind it or give yourself to it, you shortchange yourself. You don't even get to the point where you see how gratifying and how satisfying it is. So we have to make a decision to mind the things of the Spirit. If we don't, we cannot please God. What is it that pleases God? Hebrews 11:6 tells us, faith. Yeah. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. So with faith, it's possible. The only way that we can please God or be acceptable to him or to satisfy him is the life of faith. So the life of faith is a life in the Spirit. Praise God. God loves us. That will never change. He loves us. So don't get me wrong. He's not going to say, "Oh, I don't love them anymore." No, he will love us because he is love. He's incapable of anything other than love. But he won't be pleased. If we don't choose a life of the Spirit, he won't be pleased. And he's done so much for us, so much for us, that the idea of not being pleasing to him is a bit painful. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like, I don't want to disappoint my Creator.
Yes.
I don't want to disappoint the one who sent his only begotten Son just for me. Yeah. He sent Jesus just for me. He sent Jesus just for you so that we can have life and have it more abundantly. But we have to mind the things of the Spirit. Praise God. We have to mind the things of the Spirit. So that Hebrews 11:6 goes on to say, you know, it says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Diligently seek him. God is a spirit, right? And those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So if we're to seek him, we seek him in the spirit. We don't seek him with our minds. It's impossible to seek him with our minds or our flesh. We seek him with our spirit. And that's the way we can satisfy him, please him, and be acceptable. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So life in the spirit, operating, minding the things of the Spirit, is how we recognize the things of the Spirit. You know, Daddy always uses the example of the radio or the television. If he said he's going to be on the radio, but you tune into the television, where is he? Where is he? You're in the wrong place, right? We have to be in the Spirit to recognize these leadings and be able to respond to them. But if we're not even minding the things of the Spirit, we're not even in a place to hear. What did he say to us? He said, keep ourselves, put ourselves in a place. Put yourself in a position to recognize the leadings of the Spirit. I would like to say, put ourselves and keep ourselves there. Don't allow yourself the option to stop operating in that place of the Spirit. It's a requirement for us to be able to please God. Well, if you're not interested in pleasing God, well then, you know, that's something else. But I believe our heart is interested. I believe we have hearts that are interested in being pleasing to God. So that means we must mind the things of the Spirit. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. So what happens when we put ourselves in a position to recognize these leadings, then we're able to respond to them. You know, you can't respond to something you don't even recognize. It's like a phone call. If your phone is on silent, the phone call is trying to come through, but you don't recognize it. So you can't answer. You don't hear it. You won't pick it up. But if it's on, you know, your ringtone, if it's on, it's not too, you know, it's not too soft, but you can actually recognize it, then you can respond. We have to keep ourselves in a position where we're able to hear it. Too many of us operate in a place where we're dull of hearing. We're not recognizing it. And then if we don't recognize it, we can't respond. And we wonder why things aren't making progress. And Daddy had shared about that. Why is my faith not producing? Why is my faith not working? Where we have to use our faith to be in the Spirit. We use our faith to get in this place where we're able to recognize what he's saying. It's, you know, we have to change our way of thinking. Like, this is first. Not all the things that God can get me, right? You know, he also made the statement of, you know, we know what we believe, but not whom we have believed. So knowing whom we have believed is operating in the Spirit, because we have to know him in the Spirit. So it's important that our mindset is, we think first, I have to be in the Spirit. I have to learn to operate life out of the Spirit. And from this place of the Spirit, everything else will fall into place, because we're able to recognize those leadings, recognize those promptings, and then we respond. Daddy made a statement a while ago, a couple years ago. He said that obstacles are never a threat to a person moving by the momentum of the Spirit. So if we're moving in that momentum of the Spirit, anything that comes, it's not a threat, because we have momentum. We have momentum in the Spirit. So how do we get this momentum? He went on to say, responding to every leading of the Spirit gives you momentum. As long as you're moving on that momentum, no amount of obstacle can ever be a threat to you. But we have our part to play, right? We have to be in a place to recognize those leadings and then respond. We have to get so practiced at responding to every leading, every prompting, even if it's go say hi to that person. You just go say hi, it doesn't hurt you. If they don't respond, you did your part, right? God has to work on their part, but you just respond. Even if it's go give that person 50 naira, or it's like, what is 50 naira gonna do? You don't know, maybe that's all they needed to complete what they needed to purchase. It might seem minute or small to you, but it's a prompting. Obey it. Obey it. Praise God. Every leading. Don't reason it out. Too many times we reason them out. And then we miss out on what God is wanting to do. You miss out on building this momentum. And you know, when there's a momentum built, it's so hard to stop it. Like a moving vehicle, when it's going real fast, it's difficult to stop it. But if it's crawling at maybe 1 kilometer, right, per hour, it's easy to stop now. Even a man could stop it. But when it's going like 65, a man can't stop it. Praise God. You think about that momentum. When we get in that momentum of the Spirit, no obstacle can stop us now. No matter what we see or hear or feel, we've got too much momentum built up. We cannot be stopped. But it starts with us recognizing those leadings and responding. Even the smallest prompting. I know all of us have had promptings. And there's been some we responded to and others we didn't. I remember hearing a story about this minister. The Lord put it on his heart to sow a seed. And I don't remember how much it was, maybe like $1,000 or something, maybe 500. I don't remember the exact amount. But the Lord put it on his heart to sow it to somebody. But he delayed. He waited. 2 weeks later, he gave it. And then he called the person and said, did you receive it? Did it bless you? And the person was like, yeah, it blessed me, but it really would have helped me 2 weeks ago. That man had that prompting 2 weeks ago, but he delayed. So not only does not responding to those promptings right away, it stalls our momentum, but it hinders the other person. You know, God is faithful, and if you say no, he can get someone else to say yes, but things can be delayed. We have to learn to respond instantly. And the way we get that built up is by responding to those smaller promptings. If we won't respond to the prompting to give 500 naira, it will be a lot more difficult to respond to the prompting to give 5,000 naira. You have to build that momentum. It's not always money. It could be, go talk to this person. Talk to this person. Go share Jesus with them. And you don't have to be weird. Sometimes people get weird when they share Jesus with people, And I've seen some people, You don't have to be strange. You could just be yourself. The best way to witness to someone is sharing what God has done for you. God, I just heard this and I just had it on my heart to share it with you. And maybe you just share a scripture. You don't have to say the scripture, verse, chapter and verse, but you can tell them what the scripture says and just say, God said this. He said that he'd supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. And do you know, I had a need that came up. But because I was faithful in my local church, because I brought my tithe, I saw all the supply come in from all these different areas, and he really blessed me. But you know what's so wonderful? It's not just me. It's for everybody. Everybody who would believe and respond. So something simple like that, praise God, but just responding to share it with somebody. You're building a momentum. You're building a momentum. And no matter what tries to come against you, because you've built a momentum by responding to those leadings, nothing can stop you. Praise God. And then Daddy went on to say, obstacles are only a threat to an action or a movement that is not born of God. For whatsoever is born of God overcomes any obstacle. Amen. So not only, I mean, if we're obeying the promptings and the leadings of the Spirit, then it's of God. The Holy Spirit only says what the Father says. So if He's leading us, then it's of God. And it will overcome any obstacle. Praise God. And we have to learn that these movements, these momentums are connected. I believe, I don't remember if it was here or in Lagos, it was a meeting. You know, Daddy in recent times shared how Pastor Jay was ministering in the area. And he ministered to somebody. He called somebody up by the Spirit. You know, he had a word of knowledge about an illness, or I think maybe the person had cancer. And God, you know, gave that word to Pastor Jay, and he called it out, and the person came up, and they were healed. So he responded. I mean, that is an example of being in a ministry setting. He responded to the leading of the Spirit and called that out. But years later, the woman was in the area, and we were doing renovations at the church, and the church needed carpet. She heard that, and she wrote the check for, was it $20,000 to replace the whole carpet? And she was a young woman. She remembered what God had done. But that was something that God had put in place. I mean, He's not called Jehovah Jireh for nothing. He sees ahead and provides. But we must respond. We must recognize and respond to those leadings. Now, I know that was a ministry setting, but, you know, it's not just for fivefold ministers. This is how we are to live. This is how we're to operate. And so we look for those, and we know that if it's of God, it will overcome any obstacle. So even something so simple as just obeying those promptings to reach out to somebody, to talk to somebody, you know, to share the word with them, just chat, have a nice conversation that's uplifting. You know, sometimes people do not hear anything that's uplifting all day. There are some people that at home, at their job, in their transport, all they're hearing is negative. It's very true. Some people don't ever see a smile all day long. That's why wherever Daddy and I go, it's amazing. People, well, you don't see a smile on their face, but then they see us and their face lights up. Why? Because we're always smiling. We're always sharing the love of God with people. It's not even about giving them a tip. It's about sharing the life and the love of God wherever we go. We're responding to the life that's in us. And it ministers to people. Praise God. And so that's how we build that momentum. And it can be a tremendous blessing. My point is, it's not just ministry. I know that was a ministry example, but we can all do it. We can all do it. We can all respond. Hallelujah. So how do we learn to recognize these leadings? And we just have to keep ourselves in a position. We have to live and walk in the Spirit. We live and walk in the Spirit. And we know from Galatians 5:22, it's the fruit of the Spirit. If we're operating in these fruit, we're operating in the Spirit. Praise God. We're operating in the Spirit. And so it's not something that we can say, oh, I can't do that. No, if you're born again, you have the fruit of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Praise God. And then verse 25, it says, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Because we're born again, because we're in Christ, we're in the Spirit. We have to walk in the Spirit. If we walk in the Spirit, that's us minding the things of the Spirit. Praise God. And then if we're minding the things of the Spirit, we're controlled by the things of the Spirit. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. So this is who we are. If we're born again, this is who we are. This is the place we operate. Keep ourselves in position to recognize these promptings. That's keeping ourselves in the Spirit. And the easiest way to think about keeping ourselves in the Spirit is operating by the fruit of the Spirit. The Amplified of Galatians 5:22 says, but the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the work which His presence within accomplishes. So we know that if we're born again, He abides in us. This is the work that His presence accomplishes. Praise God. Hallelujah. So we have it on the inside. So we have what it takes to put ourselves and keep ourselves in a position to recognize these leadings. Amen. Praise God. So we can't say, oh, I don't have that. That's not true. We have it. Amen. We just have to respond to it. We have to keep it before us. And the more we meditate on it, the more we keep it before us, the more real it will become. Praise God. So we know that God leads us from our spirit. So if we're in the Spirit, praise God, we're in a place to recognize those leadings. And something else that Pastor has shared with us when he was teaching about, you know, why is my faith not producing, or why is my faith not working, and taking advantage of our advantages and operating in the Spirit. The praying in tongues is something he would share each time. Praying in tongues is an opportunity to quiet down our minds, right? Quiet down our minds and be more conscious of our spirit man. Be more conscious of these fruit that are in our spirit. More conscious of the place where we're to walk from and live from. Praise God. So in 1 Corinthians 14:14, it says, for if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. The Amplified says, for if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit by the Holy Spirit within me prays, but my mind is unproductive. It bears no fruit and helps nobody. Praise God. So when we pray in tongues, we're more conscious of our spirit. We're more conscious of the place where those leadings will come from. And if we're more conscious of it, we're going to recognize it. Praise God. So praying in tongues helps us to be more aware of our spirit. And it allows us to unhook from our mind. We need our minds. We can't walk around mindless, but we unhook and from our minds, and we hook up to our spirit, and we allow our spirit to lead us and guide us. Praise God. And then as our spirits are enlightened, then we can enlighten our minds. And that's part of renewing our minds. We renew our minds with the word. We need our minds. Right? We need it, but our unrenewed mind is not what's going to lead us or guide us. And if we're spirit-led, then what we're doing is we're telling our minds how to think about things. We're going to think about this the way the Word says to think about it. We're going to do things the way the Word says to do things. We're going to obey those promptings. Praise God. So that helps us. We're training our spirit to become more active. We're giving it more place by praying in other tongues. And it's not something that we, you know, it's not, it doesn't have to be a very physical exercise. You're just praying in other tongues. Brother Copeland was just sharing about how when he was introduced to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, He heard a minister talk about it. He asked his parents, is this something we should have? They said, yep. So he grabbed his wife and they went up. Praise God. I mean, he didn't even ask her. He said, it's like, this is for us. It's in the word. Let's go. And then he would just pray in tongues all the time. He would pray in tongues everywhere at all time. This is just what he did. And he attributed that so much to how quickly he and his wife developed spiritually. They developed spiritually because they gave themselves to the things of the Spirit. And because his spirit man was active, he was developing his spirit, he was able to recognize promptings and recognize leadings and obey them. And you can see a man who has made so much impact on the world for Jesus. But he's so humble, yet he's so skilled. And he's a man of excellence. We know he's human. We know, of course, he's not perfect. We're not, you know, making him a god or idolizing him. But he's an example. He's an example for us to see in so many areas. And he has so much experience. I believe he said he's been married 60 years. He'll be married 60 years. And they've been in ministry 56 of those years. He has some experience. He has some experience, and we can learn a lot. And so he's saying in the beginning what he says helped him and his wife develop and become more skillful with the things of the Spirit was praying in tongues. I know there was a time when Daddy gave us a homework assignment. We were to be praying in tongues. Was it 30 minutes? 30 minutes. 30 minutes a day. Yeah, 30 minutes a day. And so that was something, and I know that when we did that, it was, you know, setting aside that time. Because something we've learned is if you don't assign your time will assign you. You must assign your time to something. And so that's what we did. We spent 30 minutes a day praying in other tongues. Why? Because the Holy Ghost was helping us, you know, get ourselves on track. Get ourselves into a place where we recognize where we need to be focused on. We have to keep ourselves focused on our spirit. Praise God. He has answers for us. He's leading us. He's guiding us. Those who are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. That means if we're children of God, He's leading us. We don't have to pray to be led. We have to quiet our minds, focus on our spirit. Keep ourselves operating in the Spirit. Keep ourselves operating by the fruit of the Spirit so we're in position to recognize them. We recognize them and we respond. And that builds the momentum. That builds our spiritual momentum. And you have confidence. When you start to respond to those leadings and you find out, oh, praise God, I see the results or the effects, you gain confidence. I hear his voice. I recognize what he's saying to do. And you build confidence and it gets easier and easier. And what we said at the beginning is that's the only way God has promised us he will lead us. It's by that inward witness. So we should just settle it and get ourselves in position to recognize it so that we can be responding. If we don't recognize it, then we can't respond, right? So that's how we build momentum. Praise God. So we spend time praying in the Holy Ghost, praying in other tongues, so that we're building ourselves up on our most holy faith. Praise God. Building ourselves up, making progress. Praise God. That's what the Bible tells us. It's Jude 1:20. Praise God. Jude 1:20. Hallelujah. This is available to us, but we have to operate in it. There's only one chapter. And it says in the Amplified, but you, beloved, yes. Very good. Build yourselves up, founded on your most holy faith. Make progress. Rise like an edifice, higher and higher, praying in the Holy Spirit. Praise God. This is how we make progress. This is how we, and you can think of that progress as momentum. This is how we make that momentum. We're building ourselves up. praying in the Holy Ghost, and we're able to recognize the leadings, respond to them, and rebuild that momentum. Amen? And it goes on to say in verse 21, guard and keep yourselves in the love of God. So this is how we guard and keep ourselves in the love of God, praying in the Holy Spirit. The love of God is a fruit of the Spirit. If praying in other tongues keeps us in the love of God, it will keep us in all the fruit of the Spirit. This is how we keep ourselves in the Spirit. This is how we keep ourselves operating from who we really are. We are a spirit. We have a soul, and we live in a body. Our soul is our mind, our will, and our emotions. So praying in the Holy Ghost keeps ourselves and guards ourselves in the love of God and all the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, we said that, self-control, praise God, hallelujah. It keeps us there. Glory to God. So it's not something to be seen as, as works. This is our life. This is how we live. And we don't want to do it. I imagine there are times that we could do it as just doing it to check it off. You know, like, okay, whew, I prayed 30 minutes, let's go. But if it's not, how we see it and how we give ourselves to it determines how effective it really is. Because I know you can have a devotional time. Daddy's talked about it many times. You have your devotional time, you read the scripture, you read the whole chapter, but it never enters. You never act on it. You know, when people talk to you, you still sound like everybody else. So what are you doing? I mean, you're just reading. It's not like you're reading a novel. It's not for entertainment. This is life. The Word of God is God speaking to us. So every time we spend time in fellowship with Him, we're building ourselves up on our most holy faith, praying in other tongues. We're communing with the Father. We're communing with life. So have that mindset. It's not just to check it off and say, I did it. But I'm making progress. I'm keeping myself in position to recognize those leadings. I'm keeping myself in position to make progress. I'm keeping myself in position to be the best blessing I can be. Praise God. Hallelujah. I know I'm interested in that. I'm interested in being a blessing. I'm interested in fulfilling what God has called me to do. And I can't do that in the flesh. I can't do that in my mind. I have to do it by the Spirit. So we build ourselves up founded on our most holy faith. We make progress. We stay in the love of God. We stay in the Spirit, all the fruit of the Spirit, by praying in the Holy Spirit. Praise God. And that is the place where we'll recognize those leadings and we'll be able to respond to those leadings. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's so important that we see it that way. It's so important that we recognize what He's offering us. He's offering us a higher way of living. He's offering us a foolproof living. You know, like if you obey God, you cannot fail.
That's right. Amen.
If you obey what He says to do, you cannot fail.
Amen.
If you act on His word,
so
praise God,
so
you cannot fail. It's a foolproof life. Hallelujah. And you don't even have to come up with it. You just follow. Follow. Recognize those leadings. Respond to them. God makes us look good. He really does make us look so good. He will give us information ahead of time. And we act on it. And it makes us look so smart. How did you know? It was the Holy Ghost. How did you know to do that at that time? It's the Holy Ghost. Praise God. We heard a testimony in recent times. Pastor Jay and Pastor Debbie do testimonies and it was the service the Wednesday night before New Year's. So they typically have a testimony time. And there were these several people were sharing testimonies, and one of them, it was so sweet just watching, because these young people, they're married, they have two kids now. And they used to be in the youth when Daddy led the youth. So it's so precious to see how their lives have progressed, because they've stayed connected to their pastors, they've stayed with the things of God, and they've progressed. And now they're at a place, I mean, they're talking about, you know, funding the gospel. You know, they have a business, God gave them their own business. And, you know, their heart is to be a blessing to their man and woman of God. Their heart is to have people continue to hear this word. And it's just wonderful to see. But they shared a testimony, and I'll try to summarize it as much as possible. But, you know, they were needing a new house because they were, they were about to have the second baby. And they've been believing God for a house for a while. I mean, they didn't wait to the last minute. They've been believing God for one, and they wanted something that they both enjoyed. And so there were many things that happened, but they were led to a certain house. It wasn't exactly what they wanted, but God put it on their heart to take that one. And so they took it. And then they were thinking, maybe we miss God, but, you know, God really did say this. And so what happened is they were in that house for a little bit of time, and then another one came up. And this one, when they went to it, both of them loved it. I mean, I know we love Jesus, but they liked it super, 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 right? They liked it. Both of them walked in and were like, wow, this is great. Wow, this is great. Wow. And you know how you can go in a place and you really like it, but your spouse is kind of like, eh. And then you go into another place, your spouse is like, yes. And then you're like, eh. But they both were like, yes, this is awesome. But they were like, we have this other house. It doesn't seem like, you know, a good thing to try to get this other one that's way more than our you know, the maximum amount they wanted to spend. But God put it on their heart. They were being prompted, and they were led to buy this other one. But when they were walking around, the owner said to them, you know, we're prepared to do owner financing. That means that the owners would finance the property for them. They wouldn't have to go through a bank. And so then they were, and then the people said, well, we just wanted somebody who really liked the house. They only were there 3 months. They inherited it from an uncle who had passed away, and they didn't want to stay there, but they just wanted someone to really like the house. And this couple really liked the house. So not only did they offer to finance it for them, they said, you know what? You just take over our payments. So when they thought about it, these people were just, they didn't have to pay any additional interest. They didn't have to pay any additional insurance on the property. They just took over their note. So this couple was sowing so much into them. And then the house they moved from, they had actually wanted to get into real estate. And so instead of selling that other house, they turned it into a rental. And so now that house is being rented and paying for itself. And the people who are renting it, they called them perfect renters. That house was perfect for those renters. They wanted a bigger house, and it was it's what they had on their heart. So now this couple has a place that has nice land. They have outbuildings where they have a business that they need some of those buildings for. And they have other buildings they can do some things that they wanted to do for business as well. And the payment that they're making, they're not paying really any interest. They don't have to come up with the insurance. The people financed it for them. And now they're able to be a blessing to somebody else. That's how God does things. But it started with them responding to these promptings. They didn't understand everything in their head. You know, why would we want to be in this house? But the reason God got them there was so that He could get them to the next one. If they hadn't responded to taking that first one, they wouldn't have responded to the one that became their ultimate. and that God just put them in there. And now they can be an even more of a blessing. And the young man, he's very sweet. The other house allowed him to be close to his parents. And it was at a time where they really needed him to be close. So he was only 6 minutes away from them. So God did so many things for them beyond what they could have asked or thought of on their own. But they responded. They responded to those leadings, and he was able to take them into more. Amen. So I just wanted to encourage us to keep ourselves in position to recognize those leadings, recognize those promptings, and respond. Amen. There's so much. This is January, right? We're at the beginning of this year. Let's start. Like, you know, maybe you've already started. Just continue. Build that momentum. Keep it going so that we can get into all that God has for us. I know when Pastor comes back, he's going to be sharing what God has put on our heart for this year, and it's going to require our faith. It's going to require a momentum, and we can get into a momentum as a church, but it certainly helps when as individuals, we've got a momentum going. Praise God. We want it because it's not just about us. It's about all those people God is wanting to reach, and God needs all of us to be on board. Bring our faith. We can bring our faith to something beyond ourselves, and really when we do that, that's us seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, his ways of doing and being right. We're bringing our faith to what God has, and he's able to add everything to us. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Well, that's what I have on my heart for us today. I trust that it gives us something to really meditate on. Remember that list of things that God has just proven himself faithful in our lives. You want to write those down and keep them before you. Keep them in your remembrance. Remind yourself often of his faithfulness, and that will help us to keep that momentum going. It'll keep us in position to recognize the leadings. Amen.